Hi everyone, today's topic is diagnosis and this is Dr. Gautami, MDS Orthodontics, who is here before you to teach about diagnosis. So now what do you see about diagnosis? The word diagnosis itself tells you what you have to learn in this topic. Most of the diagnosis, whatever you see, you have to correlate this chapter with the occlusion content. Okay, so whenever you're reading this diagnosis chapter, kindly open your occlusion notes or your study material of your occlusion as well, because that is how you will be able to correlate. One thing in orthodontics, what I would suggest you is, for example, you have started to read occlusion chapter. Okay, so in occlusion, you have a class 1, class 2, class 3 malocclusion. When you're reading your class 2 malocclusion, always open the occlusion part, the etiology part, and then the diagnosis part and the treatment part. So when you carry it in one fashion, it becomes easier for you to correlate with the questions asked in the exam. So this diagnosis in this chapter or in this topic, we will be covering about how do we diagnose. See, for example, a patient comes to you with an age of 8 to 9 years. So you have one diagnosis. Whereas a patient who comes at the age of 13 to 14 years, definitely your diagnosis will change. So what is the change seen here? It is your age of the patient. So what happens over this age? There is some amount of growth happening. There is some amount of arch discrepancy which is happening. So in the other topics, we had covered the preventive and the interceptive orthodontics, which had shown what is the change between from your primary dentition to the mixed dentition to the permanent dentition. So what is the magic of your diagnosis is what we are going to see in this chapter. Before that, there is a word called as triage. What is an orthodontic triage? Basically, you see, whenever a patient comes to you, what you have to see is the first thing, what important, what is the chief complaint of the patient. I am very sure in your other subjects as well, what is the first thing you address to the patient? It is your chief complaint. Your diagnosis and your treatment should be based on the chief complaint of the patient. So basically, when a patient comes to you, what you should do is you should recognize what is the problem. So here is a flowchart where you recognize the problem, you formulate the problem, and you carry out the necessary examinations and interpretation of the results, and finally you arrive to the diagnosis. So today we are going to follow this whole path where you see a problem, you intercept the problem, you formulate it, how to correct it, and then you do the necessary examinations. After you do the necessary examinations, what is the interpretation? What is the inference you get? And what is your diagnosis? But before your interpretation of the results and diagnosis, there is something called as differential diagnosis, which is very important. So the wisdom of the orthodontist or the dentist or the practitioner lies when he can rule out the differential diagnosis. So let us move into the topic. What is a comprehensive diagnosis? It should be a summary of the most important facts. The comprehensive orthodontic diagnosis is established using the clinical implements called as your diagnostic aids. So basically, if a patient comes to you, what do you do? The first thing you do is you talk to the patient and then you examine the intraoral examination. So what happens after you see the intraoral examination, you have to perform a certain tests or investigations which helps you to arrive a diagnosis. So what are they? They are the essential diagnosis and the supplemental diagnosis. Now, why are they called essential and supplemental? First one is the essential ones, but later, in case you have to even furthermore diagnose and you want to know the adjuncts of the etiology of the malocclusion, then you should go for your supplement diagnostic aids. So the first step is your case examination, then is your analysis of the case, and then is the cephalometric analysis, which is an essential diagnostic aid. Then is your photographic analysis, then your radiographic analysis in case of any congenital abnormalities or in case of any impacted or unerupted tooth or any congenital absent of the teeth. What are the necessary diagnostic aids? Is like OPG, you take an OPG and you see if there is any tooth, or if it is a malpositioned tooth, if it is an impacted tooth, what is the location of the tooth is what you see in a radiographic examination. And then you have your study cast analysis. And then is the history and your case functional examination. So these eight are the diagnostic aids. So what happens in the comprehensive diagnosis? Before that, what you have to see is It is not just an 8-year-old or a 9-year-old which comes to you. Even right from the infancy stage, there are a few motor reflexes which a infant follows, and based on that, the development and the growth is assessed. So this also comes under the diagnosis. For example, these are the sequence of your actions during from the first to third month. What you see is there is a caudal eye and hand to eye and hand mouth skills and the manipulation with the hands, whereas in the 4 months they grasp things in the front. At age of 5 months, they reaches the object and holds with both the hands, and 7 months holding an object crude grasp from the palm. So this is called as your grasp reflex. Do not confuse yourself with grasp reflex and holding the object crude. What happens if you see in the babies, they tend to grasp something very hard. After that, they even leave it. The position of grasping it hard and again leaving the object is actually called as your grasp reflex. So at the age of 9 months, holding small objects like palate, bite, index and finger and thumb are the sequential order of an infant. So a malocclusion related to difficulty in producing what kind of sounds. For example, as you all know, there are different kinds of speech and sounds. So a labiodental fricative. What is a labiodental fricative? Labio, that is the sounds which are used using your lips and the teeth. So in which malocclusion do you find it difficult? So you have, in such questions, always break the question. Labiodental, that means there is a problem. He's asking what is a problem, which kind of malocclusion has a problem with labiodental. Labio means lips, dental means teeth. So which malocclusion has a problem with a coordination between the lips and the teeth? It is your skeletal class 3 malocclusion. So the answer for this is skeletal class 3 malocclusion. If you use such easy hints, it becomes easy for you to solve such questions. Next is a small table which we have formulated, that is the speech sound, the problem and the related malocclusion. So as I told you, F and V, these are the words which you use to talk or speak with the help of your lips and the teeth. So there is the related malocclusion is your class 3 malocclusion. So next, coming to the second phase, that is the language. So in the first month, what do they do is they see whenever an infant is there, they usually respond to light, they respond to sound, and they respond to the other motor reflexes. So at the first month, what they do is they turn head to the sound. In the second month, you see cooing. And in the sixth month, you see them talking the monosyllables. And in the ninth month are the bisyllables. And in the 12th month are the two words with meaning. Whereas the social diagnosis, that is the personal social diagnosis, in the second month, they start off with the social smile. Third month is recognizing the mother. And sixth month is smile at the mirror image. And ninth month waves bye-bye. And in the 12th month, they play a simple ball game. And 3 years, they know the gender. So coming to the profile of the patient, always it is examined by viewing the patient from this side. The facial profile helps in the diagnosing gross deviations in the maxillomandibular relationships. So there are three types of profiles which exist. They are straight profile. The two lines form a nearly straight line. So when you draw a line from the glabella, that is the soft tissue nasion point, to the pogonion, that is to the chin, the most prominent part of the chin, it forms a straight line basically. So this is called as a straight profile. But whereas you have a convex profile, there are two lines drawn, one from the soft tissue point of the forehead to the upper lip portion, and then from the soft tissue point of the chin to the upper lip. If you see, there is an intersection happening here and you can see a convexity here. So these two lines form an angle with the concavity facing the tissue. This kind of profile occurs as a result of a prognathic maxilla or a retrognathic mandible, as seen in class 2 div 1 malocclusion. So you know the concave profile as well. So again, if you draw a line from the forehead to the upper lip and again from the most prominent part of the chin, so if you see, there is a concavity forming here. So this type of profile is associated with a very prognathic mandible, or with a normal maxilla and a prognathic mandible or it can also be a hypoplastic mandible with a hypoplastic maxilla with a normal mandible. So this is again seen as your class 3 malocclusion. This is a very common kind of malocclusion which is seen in a hypomaxillary hypoplasia patients, especially patients with cleft palates. So what are the different types of divergences? So what we saw till now was profile. Profile and divergence are not the same. Okay. So in profile, what happens? You are basically connecting from one upper component to the lower component. But in divergence, what you only see is that the relationship of your maxilla and the mandible in respect to your cranial base. So when you draw a line here like this, so if you see that your mandible is anteriorly placed, that means it is an anterior divergence. But whereas this is your maxilla, this is your cranial, this is your mandible. If you draw a line like this, so it is going like in towards backwards. So that means it is a posterior divergence. But whereas if you see it placed in a normal straight line, then it is called as your orthognathic divergence. So as I told you here, these are the three ones. One is an anterior divergence, posterior divergence, and orthognathic divergence. So here, if you can see here, if I draw a line like this, you can see how posteriorly divergent or the mandible is just moving backwards and upwards. But whereas if you see in this situation, the mandible is moving forwards and upwards. It is not even downwards, it is upwards. So this is how you have to analyze the difference between divergence and a profile. Next is your straight or orthognathic profile. That is, the line between the forehead and the chin is perpendicular to that of the floor. That means it has a straight line. So in orthognathic diagnostic process, the facial divergence is to a large extent regulated by the patients with ethnic and racial background. Assessment of the anterior-posterior jaw relationship can be done using this method. So you should place the two fingers, one in the maxilla and one in the mandible, and try to ask the patient to open the mouth. So when the patient is opening the mouth, what you should see the path of closure, and based on that also, you can see how the divergence of the mandible is there. So this is a question. Backward path of the mandible closure is seen in which kind of malocclusion? So what do you see? Backward path of closure. That means your mandible is moving posteriorly divergent. Posterior divergence, where do you see? Posterior divergence you see in a class 2 malocclusion. So it is a class 2 diff 2 malocclusion is the answer for this. So now what all did we see? We saw profile, we saw divergence, and now we are going to see the lip step. So I'm drawing a straight line here. So what do you see here? You see a normal line like this. So this is called as your normal lip step. But whereas if you see in the next picture, I'm drawing the same line, but it is coming forward like this. So that means it is a positive lip step, which is usually seen in your class 3 malocclusion. Now similarly, if you see this, So if you see here, if I draw a line here, this is again a negative lip step. So this is seen in your class 2 malocclusions. So kindly remember, if it is a positive lip step, it is a class 3 malocclusion, and if it is a negative lip step, it is a class 2 malocclusion. So here is a question. Negative lip step is seen in which of the cases? Class 1, class 2 and class 3 or all of the above. So the answer here is B, class 2 cases. So next we saw the lip step. Now coming to the lips. Lips are the soft tissue part and they are different types of classifications, that is competent lips, consciously competent lips and incompetent lips and potentially competent lips. So incompetent lips are, it might be because of a shorter upper lip or also which do not form a lip seal in a relaxed state, or it also can be seen in your class 2 cases. So this can be achieved by active contraction of the perioral and the mentalis muscles. So potentially incompetent lips are seen which fail to form a lip seal due to the proclined upper incisors, which is seen in your again class 2 cases. So averted lips is a hypertrophied lips with weak muscular tonicity. It can be either because of a weak muscular tonicity or also it can be because of the dental relationship as well. So if it is a class 3 malocclusion also, there are chances of a hypertrophied lips. So here we have another question. Incompetent lips refer to the inability of the lip to cover the incisors in the mandibular relaxed position, inability of the lips to cover the incisors in occlusion, or the lips come in between the upper and the lower incisors, or the tongue thrust against the lips during swallowing. The answer for this is an option A, which is the inability of the lip to cover the incisors in the mandibular relaxed position. So if you can see here, there are two pictures. There is a tension in the lower lip. So this is a classical feature of your class 2 malocclusion. So what is the mentalis activity? Normally, the mentalis activity of the muscle does not show any contraction at rest. But whereas a hyperactive mentalis is seen in a class 2 Div 1 cases, so which causes the puckering of the chin. This causes a puckering of the chin, that is the hyperactive mentalis. So there is another question here. Hyperactive mentalis activity is seen in class 1, class 3, class 2 div 2 or class 2 div 1. So how to learn this topic? For example, this is your class 2 malocclusion. This is your maxilla. At the age of 8 or 9, what happens is because of the retruded mandibular position, what happens? This is the step which is formed, if you can see. So what happens? This mentalis, this area, whatever is there, is hyperactive. In order to meet the occlusion standards, it becomes hyperactive in nature. So that leads to a hyperactive mentalis, especially which is seen in your class 2 Div 1 cases. So hyperactive mentalis is a classical feature of your class 2 Div 1 cases. A normal nasolabial angle. Now what is a nasolabial angle? Yeah. So if I draw a tangent line, see the word naso and labial. So that is an angle between, you have to take a center point. You should draw a tangent from here and a tangent from here. So this angle is called as your nasolabial angle. So the average nasolabial angle is 80 degree. So this nasolabial angle is 80 degree for an ideal occlusion. But in case of a different malocclusions, it will definitely vary. For example, it is a class 2 malocclusion. That means this is more forwardly placed. That means the angle tends to move, becomes more smaller. So in a class 2 case, your nasolabial angle is smaller. In a class 3 case, your nasolabial angle is larger. So it will be either acute or obtuse. So it is the angle formed between the lower border of the nose and a line connecting the intersection of the upper lip to the tip of the lip. Normally it is 110 and it is acute in class 2 malocclusion and obtuse in your class 3 malocclusion. Vertical malocclusions include a lateral deep bite, a complex deep bite, gingivally supported deep bite, and a gingivally supported open bite. So basically, your vertical malocclusions is always gingivally supported deep bite. So what happens in all the three directions, in sagittal, transverse, and vertical? There is distoocclusion and your mesoocclusion. There is a crossbite and buccal malocclusion and lingual malocclusion, which can occur in a transverse direction, and deep bite and open bite in a vertical malocclusion. The deep bite anomalies are divided into dentally supported and gingivally supported. So how do you classify the faces in orthodontics? So you have three types of faces, that is dolichocephalic, mesocephalic, and brachycephalic and hyperbrachycephalic. In dolichocephalic, it is a long and narrow head. They have narrow dental arches. So basically, it is an oval shape and a long face. Whereas mesocephalic is an average shaped head with 80.9, and this is 75.9 is these measurements of the faces. And in brachycephalic, it is either 81 to 85. And whereas in hyperbrachycephalic, it is 85, more than 85.5. So what is the significance? In dolichocephalic, usually they have narrow dental arches. And whereas in mesocephalic, they have a normal arches. But whereas in a brachycephalic, they have broad dental arches. So here the question is, dolichocephalic refers to long wide face, long narrow face, short wide face, and short narrow face. It is the long narrow face. So till now what we saw was the profile, the divergence, the lip steps, and the competency of the lips. And now we are seeing, and we also saw the shape of the face. Now the shape of the head. In extraoral examination, the shape of the head, the measurement can be evaluated according to the cephalic index of the head, that is the maximum skull width divided by the maximum skull length. So the width divided by the length. So based on this, if the cranial index is 89.5, what then the head will be what? So what did we see? It is dolichocephalic. As the values show, it is dolichocephalic. Coming to the functional analysis. So till now we have seen only the extraoral analysis. Now coming to the functional analysis. In functional analysis, what you have to see is the TMJ, the action of TMJ or the process of TMJ. What is TMJ? Under the TMJ examination, what all you should do? First is the auscultation, the palpation, functional analysis, and radiographic examination. So first, you have to check for the object, that is with using a stethoscope, you have to check what is the auscultation, if you are finding any crepitus or any tremors, if you can hear. Next is the palpitation. After the palpitation, what you have to do is you have to check the hyperactive activity of your TMJ muscles by palpating on the TMJ area. Next is your functional analysis. Here, the TMJ and the mandibular excursions, occlusion in rest position and premature contact, any dysfunctions, or if there is any deviation in the path of closure, you ask the patient to open the mouth and close. So whatever your functional analysis all comes under, whether in the rest position, how is the TMJ? When the patient is opening the mouth, how is the TMJ? You have to palpate there and see. So all of this comes under the functional analysis. So under auscultation, what all do you see? If you see if there is any crepitus, if there is any clicking, or if there is any palpatory. Under functional analysis, you have to check for any dislocation, any hypermobility, any limitation, any deviation, or any orofacial dysfunctions. And in the radiographic examination, you have to check for any dislocation or change and shape in the morphology of the TMJ is what you have to check. What is Vogelgeist? So this is one kind of inhibited growth of the mandible due to ankylosis of TMJ. So this is one kind of symptom what you see. For example, there is a problem, ankylosis of the TMJ. When there is ankylosis there, that restricts the growth of the mandible. So that condition is called as Vogelgeist. Column angle is seen in which of the following conditions? First of all, what is a column angle? A column angle is an angle between the crown and the root within the same tooth, that is the upper central incisor. A normal angle is 180 degree. In a class 2 diff 2, this column angle is reduced. So, the maxillary arches of the patients with this malocclusion are narrower than normal, but significantly they are larger than the widths which are seen in your class 2 div 1 patients. Few of these patients have posterior crossbites as well. So, column angle is seen in which of the following? So, here the answer is class 2 div 2 malocclusion. So we have come to the next part, that is the skeletal maturity indicators. Basically, this is a sexual maturation chart which is used on long observation. So you use this to see if there is what is the chronological age of the patient and what is the biological age, which is determined by the skeletal, dental and the morphological age and the onset of puberty. The skeletal age assessment is very essential. Skeletal maturation refers to the degree of development of the ossification of the bone. But why is it necessary for us? Now you take, what are the skeletal maturity indicators? I'm very sure it is the hand wrist x-ray or the hand wrist radiograph which you take. So what do you see? You basically see the stages of ossifications of your bones. So in these cases, what you see is that the stage of ossification is examined. Now why do you need this hand wrist radiographs? What happens, for example, a patient who comes to you at the age of 10, 11, what all do you check there? You find a skeletal malocclusion there and you want to do some amount of growth modification. Growth modification means using some of the myofunctional appliances. So if you want to use them, you need to know how much amount of growth is still remaining in the kid. For example, a 10-year-old girl, female patient comes to you, definitely she will be on the onset of puberty. Or if a 12-year-old female patient comes, she will have an onset of puberty. But whereas a 12-year-old male patient comes, he will have more amount of growth left. That we know arbitrarily, but we have to know exactly how much amount of growth is left, like 25% of growth, 65% of growth. All this can be evaluated by a hand wrist radiograph based on the cappings of your distal phalanges and the capping and the fusion of your phalanges. We can make out that what is the growth status of the patient. So for example, a patient who is 12 years old comes to you and you take a hand wrist radiograph and you see that there is still 65% amount of growth left in the kid. So what you can do, you can use that 65% of growth and modify, and you can bring about the myofunctional changes. Like for example, you can give a twin block appliance which will definitely build up his social profile. So this is a very important diagnostic aid in respective with the age and in perspective of your myofunctional appliance, especially during the growth period. This is one of the essential diagnostic aid and helps us to know how much amount of growth is remaining. Or example, if you can take a 13-year-old or a 14-year-old female patient comes to you, you don't know, she has already reached the puberty or she hasn't reached the puberty. So how do you know that what is the amount of growth left? You have your pre-pubertal growth spurt. So if she's in her pre-pubertal growth spurt, you can right away start with the treatment. But whereas if she still has some amount of growth left and still there is time, then you can keep her on a latent phase and you can give her some other orthodontic appliance rather than accelerating her growth status. So this is why a hand wrist radiograph is very much important. So the bones associated include the ulnar sesamoid, the pisiform and the hook of the Hammett and the metacarpals. This assessment is known as carpal index. So how do you analyze this diagnostic records? So if you can see here, there are two pictures. The bone, what you see here is your ulnar sesamoid. These are the hook of Hammett's and these are your pisiforms. So the maturation indicators and the pubertal growth spurts, that is the voice change, is seen in three stages. So here the prepubertal voice, the pitch of the voice has not changed noticeably. But whereas here the pubertal voice, the pitch of the voice had changed noticeably, but it is not acquired a adult characteristic. So in such situations where you don't know whether the voice has been changed of the male and has reached the puberty or not, or if he is reached up till the adult characteristic or not. But whereas the male voice, the pitch of the voice had acquired the adult characteristic. So this is one of the classical feature, like a patient comes to you, you don't know what is the growth status. Now you can ask them that what if the if they've reached their physical puberty or not, but you yourself do not know what is the stage. Now you know there is 55% of growth left, but how much amount of active potential growth? See, 55%, that means 45% of growth is still left in the patient. But what will you do after that? So to reach this 45% exact number, you need to know what timing you have to give your appliance. So in order to give the timing of the appliance, this maturation indicator, that is a pubertal growth spurt, is very much important. If you compare the sex of the patient, that is male or the female, in females they reach the puberty much faster than compared to males. So the timing what we get to do a growth modification is very less compared to your males. But whereas in males you have long amount of growth period left. But the only disadvantage is that you don't know the prepubertal growth spurt in males. So when does the voice crack, or when does the voice crack change occurs, and to what stage do they reach, is what we don't know. So in such cases, when you take your hand wrist x-ray, based on the ossifications and based on the appearance of the sesamoid bone, you can know what is the status of the growth. So now, what are the normal growth spurts? The first peak is seen at 3 years. The second peak is seen at 6 to 7 years for females and 7 to 9 years for males. And the third peak is seen at 11 to 12 years for females and 14 to 15 years for the males. So what are the different types of skeletal maturity indicators? That is your hand wrist radiograph, cervical vertebrae, mid-palatal suture, and the tooth mineralization. So if you see here, this is how you have to know about your anatomy of the skeleton in the hand. So here you have the first, these are your carpal bones, that is basically you have three types of bones, that is your phalanges, metacarpals, and carpals. So this is your trapezium, this is your trapezoid, and this is your capitate, and this is the sesamoid bone. So these are the different types of bones which you should know. So based on the ossification between all these phalanges is what will determine the amount of growth left. So one of the most common method which we use is the Fishman's skeletal maturity index. Fishman's skeletal maturity index is one of the most commonly used skeletal maturity indicator to use for the anatomy of the skeleton of the hand. So based on the ossification of these phalanges and the distal phalanges, we can consider that this is the growth status of the patient. So this brings us to the end of the diagnosis topic, where we have seen what all have we seen in this topic. We have seen how to diagnose a case based on the clinical examination, how to assess a profile of the patient, how to assess the divergence of the patient, how to assess the soft tissue landmarks, that is your lips, whether it is competent, incompetent, different lip steps we have seen. We have also seen the position of your TMJ and what are all the effects you see in TMJ in case of the diagnosis, and what are all the different malocclusions you see in respect to the different angles. So these are all what you have seen in diagnosis. So the one of the major part is the skeletal maturity indicator, as I have explained right away now, that based on the ossification centers and even on the phalanges and the metacarpals, you determine the growth status, which helps you to diagnose at what time should you give a treatment to the patient. So I hope in this chapter, you make a note of all the cephalic index, facial indexes. These are very important numericals in this chapter, and even the Fishman's skeletal maturity index is one of the very important diagnostic criteria which you should learn and make a note of it. So the type of questions, if you see in this chapter, what we have included is or a little vague questions, because the other pattern of questions are way direct. But some terms like column angle and all, which are not really available in much of the materials, we have added those so that they don't turn out to be a bounces for you in your examinations. Thank you.